Okay, welcome you guys. Thank you so much for coming today. I'm really excited. I just want to share with all of you. I'm trying to see if I can see all of you. I can see some of you. Okay, this is going to be a class divided into three parts. So I just want to let you guys know. So there's going to be a little bit of a discussion lecture portion, and then we're going to go through the emotions, actually embodying the emotions. So you can have your camera on or off. It's up to you. Sometimes, you know, it's nice to see what other people may be interpreting or see how it can look in the camera to yourself, or you can have it off, whatever you're most comfortable with. The second part is going to be exploring these emotions. And then the third portion is going to be dance. So it's going to be a mix of a lot of things put into one. We are stemming from classical texts, meaning the Natyasastra, which is like the dance drama text, the fifth Veda within ancient India. But I want you to understand that we are not by any means doing full-on classical dance or anything. We are briefly touching over this vast, vast dance form and just using it to understand the juices of emotions and kind of get a taste, just a quick taste, if you will, you know, of a sample and how to kind of use that in our form of dance. So by no means are we, because classical dance is, it goes very extensively, and I don't want to, you know, be offending any of our forms. It's just more of us stemming from that and applying those, how it makes us feel into more pop versions of dance. So I just wanted to say that to all of you. So first of all, hello to everybody, and thank you for being here. I'm really excited to have you all. I'm just gonna get right into it. So I think if you guys read the description, I wanna make sure, does everybody have the chart on them? There's a chart of the rasas and the bhavas. I don't know if you guys have that chart. Amy, is that chart available by chance?
So Katie's next to me here, and I think she's gonna put a link or file in the chat right now.
Okay, great. We don't need this chart at that very moment, but we're gonna be using it in a little bit. So basically it's a chart of emotions that we're gonna be playing with and expressing in the middle. So I think that's the chart given right there. And so you guys can click on it just whenever you want to have reference, and I'll allude to it as well. Okay. So basically, Indian dance is very vast. You might see a lot of Bollywood. You might be familiar with pop dancing and all these styles of dance that are very popular and very expressive and have a lot of emotions. We definitely emote a lot in Indian dance. There's a lot happening not only with the body, but with the hand gestures, with the face, with lip syncing. There's an emotion that's coming out in the dance. So it's not just about physical movement and an essence. It's basically like you are emoting this emotion from within. And that is expressing itself through a dream sequence, through drama. Because in ancient India, dance was not just dance. It was dance, theater, singing, music, acting, all in one. And there was no performer audience discrepancy, meaning like today in the theater, a lot of people go to watch at a theater space or pay tickets or observe and critique even at times on these dance spaces. So, or these performers, or there's, you know, like dance critics. And that in within traditional Indian dance, that didn't really exist. The performer and the audience were one. You are experiencing one thing, and the audience is responding to whatever the performer is performing. So basically, it's not like there's any critique or you're thinking about how's this performance going. It's you are immersed in the performance with the performer, and you're responding to the performer. So these aspects, you're cheering, you're shouting out, you're crying, you're expressing. It's very loud. It's very, again, full of emotion. And the performer, on the other hand, they kind of call it the yoga of dance. So with the Natyashastra, it's this fifth Veda, if you guys are familiar with the Vedas at all, these ancient Indian yogic texts. This was kind of known as the fifth Veda by Bharat Muni. And what was so amazing about this text is he kind of puts the arts and yoga in one. That the performer is like a vehicle, and the performer is like a yogi in a sense, but the person, the individual is working on clearing themselves so they're not judging any emotion. There are universal emotions, which we'll get into in a second. And there's tiny sub-emotions that can go on forever. And basically, if we work on ourselves, and we're not judging any emotion as a performer, whether that's anger, you know, like the dark emotions, anger or jealousy or greed or mirth, you know, any of these that might, where you're not judging the emotion, you're letting it fill you up as a creator, as a performer, and you're expressing it out. So these emotions come up through many different things. So the performer is like a cook. This was in the description. You might have seen it for this class. The performer is like a cook. And these emotions that we're storytelling with are like ingredients. And when we cook these emotions as the performer, as we practice with our technique, skill, and application with story, you know, through not only hand gestures and emotions, but through the aspect of storytelling, abhinaya, we're going to create a dish. And that dish can have many flavors. It can go from mild to spicy. It can be many variations. And that taste, that flavor of that performance is what the audience tastes. That is known as rasa. So rasa is flavor, juice, essence. So for example, if there is a emotion of fear, okay? So if we have fear as an emotion, there can be many types of fear. There can be many types of love. So if I take another example of love, okay? There can be love like a small flirt to like a huge romantic crush. There can be motherly love. There can be romantic love. There can be love for the divine. There's so many different types of love, and there's so many different spice ranges. So depending on what I'm trying to express, I will do that with psychological emotions. So like, what are the things that cause me to love this person? Is it physical attraction? How do they look? Are they pretty sexy? You know what I mean? What is going on in my head? What are the physical conditions? Is it spring? Am I expressing spring through my hands? You know what I mean? Flowers blooming. And then what is the emotion that's happening within me, the character, the person that I'm performing? And so all of these together are going to create some kind of emotion in the observer. So rasa, this emotion, this flavor, cannot be experienced without the audience. So there is this, whoever's observing on that same playing field, again, not up or down, but that neutral playing field, because performers used to be in the center and all would be seated all around on a seated level. You are experiencing that together. And so this is just a taste of, hey, what does that feel like? And how do we express through our face, through our eyes, through our emotions? Because sometimes it just gets disconnected straight at the body level. And so this is that little taste as cooks, as performers, that we're gonna try to create these dishes. But again, being a dancer and being a person who's working on their ego go hand in hand. Because according to what I found, and what I personally believe also, that becoming a better performer and becoming a better person go hand in hand, because that practice is only going to make you work on your ego, work on yourself even more, so you can be open. Because you know, actions are individual, but emotions are universal. This is in the Natyasastra. So what I mean by that is that we can all express anger in different ways, but that feeling of anger, that feeling from within, we can all understand. And so when you're watching a performance, even if it's not in a language you understand or movement that you understand, you can understand, even with classical, many types of classical Indian dance, you can understand like, oh, I may not know what the story is, but I can see on that face or the way that they're expressing what's going on inside. And that's powerful. That breaks down barriers. And it's a language that I feel that words can't get through, but art can. And so that's why I find it extremely, extremely powerful. And emotions are physical, you know, they are lied in our gut. So the emotions that they talk about in the Natyashastra are connected to our gut. It's a guttural response. So it's not just, you know, feelings of the heart or things in the mind. It's how our instinctual reactions are. And so expressing those things without limitations is quite beautiful. So it's about taking that feeling of whatever those emotions are, a combination of emotions, like anger and wonder may create curiosity, may create jealousy. So these, again, these thousands of dishes, you know? So going into that, we've got classical dance. There's many forms of classical dance where there's a teacher technique relationship. So you're listening to a specific teacher. You've got a relationship that you go through specific technique, years of training. And then you have folk dance, which has nothing to do with any kind of technique or any kind of guru relationship. It's free form. It's representing the movements of the people, movements of the society, the culture, the way they live their lives, how they express. So Bollywood as a pop form is a combination of some Indian classical, some Indian folk, different pop styles from India, and different styles from around the world. So there's not just one type of Bollywood. It stems from whatever's going on in the story, and they express that deep dream sequence or express that emotion in a certain way. So just to give you an understanding of, we're going to be taking a few aspects of classical, one of the classical Indian dances, there's about 8 to 9 at least, from the Natyashastra. And then we've got, you know, folk styles a little bit that we're going to mix into as well. So yeah, that's a little bit of an understanding of the dance form. And I'm going to say one more thing. Dance has been through a lot. Even this form that we're going to be diving into called Bharatanatyam. You may have heard it. There's a lot of, you'll see a lot of like very specific postures, hand gestures that come specifically from South India. And it was known before Bharatanatyam as Sadir dancing, or before that Devadasi dancing. And I want to give you an example of what dance, like classical dance in India has been through. Like due to colonization, politics, patriarchal issues, et cetera, et cetera. So an example is that Bharatanatyam was kind of, again, stemming from the Natyashastra that Bharata Muni wrote, it was expressing human emotion. It wasn't expressing love for the divine. It was very much expressing does it mean to be a human? That love, even when it's sensual love, sexual love, how we live as human beings, it wasn't shy, it wasn't covered up, you know? And over time, what happened was that this, even Abhinava Gupta comes in later on and he changes it and he says, no, this is a little too out there. We're gonna add a 9th emotion that has to do with the divine. It's called the Shanta, the peaceful one in the center. And you guys will notice that. And he made it that the love was not like sensual, sexual love that we're representing of humans. It's going to be love for the divine. So they became temple dancers. And these women and some men were dancing. They dedicated their lives to the gods. So it had this spiritual, religious shift, if you will. Then come in the colonizers, the British colonized. And before that, the Mughals invaded for 1,000 years. And they made it a prostitution form. So they completely sexualized it, completely ripped it of its meaning. And it had a very notch dancer, like showgirl, prostitutional stripper type form, and was degraded. And then by the time India got independence in 1947, it went through a nationalist form. And what happened there was that it turned from, in order to not have any connotation with sexuality or being a prostitutionalized form, it was then changed into a very classical, traditional, proper. It was made for the stage. The dresses were covered up. The movements were made faster and more technical. And it was stripped of its human experience because they didn't want to have anything to do with being associated with the prostitutionalized form. So what happened was even the movements that we say, okay, well, they stem from a certain lineage, just like yoga, they go through so many changes and forms. And there's not particularly one style that you say, okay, that's the proper way. That's the original form. But what did it do for females and how they express themselves? Because if you look at Bollywood and all these films, they're so sensual, sexual, seductive. You look at the temples outside, all the statues, they're very expressive because these forms actually weren't ones that were hidden from society. They were very openly displayed. So what does that have to say about the modern performer today and the style that is, in a way, could be seen as even conservative at times? So these are just interesting questions that pop up and the transition of the dance as a whole. So yeah, I wanted to give you guys a little bit on that just to give you a little taste. The lecture portion is over. And we're gonna go now into just understanding these different emotions and playing around with them. So if we could bring up the chart for a second, that would be awesome. If you guys have, you don't have to bring it up on the screen, I apologize. I want you to click on the chart. So can I, you guys who I can, maybe some of you see in the screen, can you give me a thumbs up if you do see the chart, if you can open it up? Yes? Are you guys able to? You can just give me a thumbs up if possible. Yes? Okay, thank you. Thank you, Amy. Okay, so I do want you guys to play into the camera here. I know I've given you a lot of information, but I wanted you to have a little bit of understanding of the background and kind of a little bit of what we're gonna play with. So if you look on the chart here, we see different bhavas, emotions, and their corresponding rasa. So if you see, for example, we've got rodra, anger, okay, in the top left corner. Now, what I've given you is the emotion on one side. I've given you the rasa, the flavor on the other side. And on the very bottom of that square is an example of how we would express that with our emotions and physical expressions, hand gestures. So in classical Indian dance specifically, you have technique footwork, you have emotions and expressions, and then you have theater all put together after years of training. So right now we're just gonna play with this. Now you don't have to do this a specific way. This is not like you have to follow a certain technique. I just want you to be open to playing with how that makes you feel. So whatever emotion I'm going to describe, we're gonna describe it with the physicality. I'm gonna explain how I'm gonna do it. And I want you to have the freedom to explore. So if your body takes you a certain place, if your expression takes you a certain place, play with that. So this is really about exploration and I want you to have fun, all right? Okay, so for example, if I'm starting with Raudra, okay? Now, anger, rage, fury. Again, on the spice level, that can be something just mildly ticks you off to something that infuriates you, right? So there's such a range of what anger looks like, okay? So if I'm doing anger and I'm expressing it, again, there's a rise in the body. When anger comes in, it's like something shoots out from underneath you. If we're gonna do a medium level of anger, there's wide eyes, and heavy breathing, and sort of a glare, whether it's looking at other people or that individual person, there's something inside you. Your heart could be trembling, your eyes could be wide, and again, that hard breath work, right? Now, from there, if Shiva, that's the extreme form, when Shiva opens his third eye, it's called, when he, like, his third eye opens and just destructs everything in his path, he takes his two fingers. There's many ways to do this, just so you know. I'm just giving one way, okay? You're going to bring your middle finger forward and the front finger out, kind of like a sideways peace sign. He opens his eyes and shakes the hands forward. The fingers go shaking forward. There's fire coming out of that third eye. And even if he stands, there's a level of rise up. Again, breathing of the chest. And there's rage. If Kali comes in, the goddess of death, she's going to pull up, whether it's a spear, bow and arrow, or her knife, and rise up and demolish, okay? So that's an example of Raudra, all right? So I want you to go full on out with that. Now, if there's a small anger, like just a little bit like of a being pissed off, how would you express that? Like, you're not gonna really let it show. You may cross your hands, you may be like, ugh, that took me off, but like, you're annoying, you know? So if you're gonna express that, how subtle would that be? How much inner life is there? You know what I mean? Okay. So we're gonna go to the next one now. Let's see. Rati, over to your right side. Shringara, this is attraction, okay? This is a really fun one. Love, delight, erotic, known as the sensual. Now, there's different kinds of love, like I said. Motherly love for a child. There's romantic love, love for the divine, etc. So let's choose romantic love right now. And again, that spectrum of like small flirt to like complete infatuation. So we've got a smiling face, playful eyebrows and side eye glances. So for example, if I see somebody and they're real cute, I'm gonna have a smiling face, playful eyebrows, and side eye glances. Like, oh, you make my heart flutter. Oh, wow, you're so cute, but I'm gonna pretend like I don't see you. Yeah, so there's a little flirtation there. So I want you guys to really play with that. Again, exactly, what does that look like? It doesn't have to be what I'm doing. What does that look like to you when you're flirting? And now that infatuation grows, oh my God, he makes me so nervous. I'm sweating, I can't talk, he or she, whoever you are, okay? And I'm dumbstruck around you. You know, how does that make me feel, right? Beautiful, does it make me sweat? Do I need to walk around for a second? Do I need to throw water on my face? Yes. Beautiful, beautiful, I'm loving this, yes. So be free, I want you to express as much as possible. All right, let's try another one. We're gonna try Bhayanaka. This is the top right corner. This is fearsome, the terrifying, okay? So hands and feet trembling, shriveling. So when you're afraid, okay, if you're sincerely afraid, you may just collapse, you may shrivel, you may go down. Your eyes may get big, your hands might be to your side. You may look around, you may be looking around. Is that person still there? Or a sound scared me. Oh my God, it made me react. Yes, oh my goodness, I can't. I'm so afraid. Good, beautiful, beautiful. Oh my God, and you come back. Beautiful, beautiful. So these hand gestures kind of help guide us into bringing that emotion out, okay? Next one, let's do Hasya. This is in the bottom left corner. It's jovial merriment, the comic laughter. So So this is actions of laughing, all right? So this is gonna be a small chuckle to like extremely hilarious to like, you're crazy and like, I don't wanna do anything with you. You know what I mean? There's so many different things. So if I'm gonna do this, anything that's more uplifting and energy, I'm gonna sit a little taller and I'm gonna laugh back, maybe tilt my head back, maybe say, oh my God, you're so ridiculous. That's not even funny. You think you're funny. Yeah, that's hilarious. Yeah, no. Or a little chuckle, like, oh my God. Just a tiny one. Yeah. Yep, exactly. Or if you're making fun of somebody, like, oh my God. Oh, did you see her? Did you see what she was wearing? No, I would never do that. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Beautiful. Beautiful. All right. From there, let's try Shanta. That's in the center. This is the one that was added by Abhinavagupta. This wasn't in the original eights, but this had to do with the divine. So when you're in a state of equanimity, there's a calm. The eyes are only half open or maybe almost closed. There's calm breath, known as the Ujjayi breath, almost that victorious breath. You're gonna take a deep breath in, out. Everything settles. Your hands can be down, or you can take the hand up and stare at one point. Your drishti, your gaze is at one point and one point only. You may close your eyes. There may be a subtle smile. Two more deep breaths in. Full breaths from your belly. One more. And you may open your eyes. So there's an interesting thing here where sometimes when we're going through different emotions and we're playing, so supposedly in different boxes, actors use these techniques as well. I'm an actor and this is part of what I do. Sometimes when you need to come back to center or kind of wash whatever emotion you were getting into, this is a good place to come back into as an exercise. So from here, we're gonna go into Karuna over to the left, compassionate, okay? So there's, from this emotion of sorrow, many rasas can come out. If we're expressing sorrow in some way in a particular story, the audience may receive that in many ways. It could be grief, empathy, compassion, pity. However, so this is more of a seated emotional expression. And there's a reaching out. So I take kind of my thumb into my three fingers here, and I reach out with a gentle touch. And I express with my eyes and my eyebrows that I do care, that I see you, that there's empathy. I can feel your pain. Or there's sorrow to myself. What have I done? Grief, moaning, sadness, heartbreak, somebody dying. So that can be full on. That can be moaning, groaning, falling on the floor, expression that really is, can seem over the top, but it really gets the message across when you're expressing it without words. So it can really just be like going down to the side, throwing yourself on the ground, really just moments of sadness. How does sadness make you feel? Again, touching that psychosomatic part of your body, body and the mind, how does your body react? There's heavy breathing. There's constant tears coming down the eyes. There's a sadness. There's a downwardness energy with this emotion. So how does that make one feel? Versus when you're crying by yourself, you're all internal. You can't see. You may put a fake smile, but you can't see. It's very inward. Beautiful. From here, we've got jugupsa, bibatsa, disgust, something where it's loathsome, repulsive. So when something is, you know, you get disgusted by, you want to kind of push back. There's a body drawing in, a face pinched, sometimes a spit out, you know, or something didn't smell good. You know how you hold your nose. We know what we do when we have emotional responses. How do you hold your nose? How do you look away? I can't do that. You draw in. Disgusted. Yes. Very nice. I like the movements that I'm seeing. All right, we've got a few more. So we've got one called Utsaha. This is Vira, valor. We've got courage, strength, vigor, energy, the heroic. So for example, when I see in the performer, in the storyline, utsaha, valor, that's the emotion he's portraying. But it invokes in me moments where I feel like I need to have courage, where I need to have strength, where I need to have vigor. You know what I mean? And so I want, how I would do that motion is going to be poise, attention, standing up taller, chin up, maybe holding one of the weapons, if it's very literal, going into war. Or just this moment, again, of rising up, confidence. What does that look like when you're going to face a thing that either scares you or you're brave, or if there's bravery coming out? Now, also to remember, bravery doesn't always, we don't always look brave when we feel like we're going to do an act of courage. It takes courage. So we're not playing courage, but we're playing those moments that really allow us to become full of, like, to do the thing that we need to do, okay? So we're gonna, we can walk forward. We can lift those fists, a tight fist. We can lift our chin up. We can gaze in front without looking anywhere else. Courage, okay? Valor, vigor, and energy. All right, now we've got Adbhuta, Vismaya, wonder. This is the marvelous, amazement, mysterious, in awe. This involves, if you come into new space, maybe your Chronicles of Narnia or your Harry Potter, completely different world. And there's wide eyes, raised eyebrows, no blinking, and gazing all around. So I'm just in complete wonder. I look around. There is no blinking. I look, whether it's even God himself in Hinduism that's come down onto earth, and I just look and I gaze. What a miracle. How wondrous is this? I'm amazed, starstruck, awestruck. Exactly, your creativity and imagination grow. Exactly, yes. And the last but not least, we're gonna go to Bhayanaka, Bhaya, fear. We actually already did fear, but I want you guys to also experience it if you're going to terrify somebody. So if I'm gonna terrify somebody, if Kali comes in that form and she's going to strike, there's this feminine energy that comes through. I'm gonna lift up my spear and strike. Without any hesitation, I lift up the spear and I strike. Lift up the spear and strike. She also sticks out her tongue. She sticks out the tongue. Eyes. Yes, that inner mother has awakened. Now, the beautiful, beautiful, everybody. The beautiful thing about this is that there's masculine and feminine energy in all of us. We may be different types of people, but we have different energies. We all have masculine, feminine, different kinds of energies inside of us. So awakening those different parts of us comes alive when we do these movements, okay? All right, so everybody feeling okay with this? Now, we're going to play a little bit of a story game. So what I'm gonna do is you're gonna get up, I'm gonna get up with you. You're gonna find your space in the room. The room is gonna be your story. Now, obviously we're not, don't worry, we are not doing classical Indian dance, but again, we're stemming from this. So just these ideas. So I'm gonna narrate a story, and using the emotions we have just done, we're going to act out this story with our body and movements, okay? All right, so you're just gonna find a nice space. And if you cannot see me, feel free to alert me in some way, but I think you should be able to. All right. Okay, so how I want you guys to start out, first of all, is we're gonna start out by giving a namaskar, a namaste to this classical Indian dance form, which we are studying from. You're gonna take your feet together, all right? You're gonna take your feet together and you're gonna open them like ballet first position. You're gonna bend your knees. You're gonna take your hands behind your back, like so. So I am bending deeply, all right? And the namaskar is kind of thanking Mother Earth for stepping on her. So you're gonna stay, bend your right foot and you're gonna bend your left foot. You're gonna come down as far as you can. You're gonna touch the ground or pretend to touch the ground. Touch your eyes, because we ask for blessings from the feet in our culture. So this is, these are Mother Earth's feet. We rise up to the skies, bring our palms together, feet together in a namaskar. And this is how we start and end these dances, okay? All right, beautiful. So now we're gonna go through this story, okay? Now imagine you are a warrior of any kind, and you're walking through the jungle. So I'm gonna take my hands behind my back. I'm gonna be alert. My energy is up, because in my gut, if I have to be cautious, my energy is high up. And I step, I kind of kick with, this is the walking form of dance. So I'm gonna kind of kick with my heels. Kick with my heels.
and I'm alert. Now, if I'm a warrior, I probably have a bow and an arrow that I keep in my back pocket. I probably have a sword as well, all right? So I'm walking around with caution behind the trees, all right? I peer behind. So I want you to imagine your forest, your jungle space. I'm walking around. All of a sudden I hear a noise and I get scared. I gasp. So what do? You freeze. You hide behind a tree. Again, you hear another noise. Eyes are big. Eyes are wide. What does that look like? Where is it coming from? I'm looking all around. I probably have my sword or my bow and arrow ready to defend myself. Beautiful. I hear the sound one more time and now I'm curious. What? That sound doesn't sound like a jungle animal. It sounds like a baby crying. So I peer closer. I walk through. I peer. Now your version of what that looks like. Your version. I peer through and I hear a baby. And my heart melts. I hear it. I hear the baby and my heart melts. I open and I see that the baby is by itself. And so I'm cautious. Is this a trap? Why is the baby here? Why so? I go down to gather, I pick up the child to stop it from crying. So I pick up the child, I cradle the child. What would you do to this child to calm it down? Okay, it's probably hungry, probably needs water or food. You cradle the child. Now there's a feeling of courage that comes inside of you. You're gonna protect this child. So there's courage, you rise up, you take the baby, you make sure that nobody is around and you continue with your journey. All right, now carrying the baby. You adore this baby, okay? This baby is just adorable. Not like other ugly babies, this is quite a cute baby. So I'm gonna go over, I'm gonna pluck some flowers, maybe put it in the baby's hair. Give it some water to drink. But I have adoration towards this child. This child brings something in me, okay? Whatever that feeling may be. And I walk around with this feeling. Okay, beautiful. Now there's another noise. And again, I'm cautious. Where is this coming from? I peer through and I see another person. This person's actually kind of cute. So I step back. I look again. I'm kind of shy. Again, I go closer, but I say, no, I have other things to do. So I keep going. I keep going through the forest. Beautiful, still carrying the baby in my hand. And now I've come across something that's much, much, much scarier. So I've come across and there's blood. And now I'm terrified. What am I going to do? I place this baby down aside and I walk through, I go down, I'm terrified. There's blood on the ground. I don't know where it's come from, it's fresh. So it makes me wonder. I'm terrified for just a moment, all right? And I'm looking around, I'm gasping. And I see the trail. There's a trail of blood. I follow that trail. Follow. I carry the baby once again. I follow the trail. And I find an animal is hurt. All right? So I go down and then I hear another animal. And I'm alert. I might have to strike. There's a sword that I bring out. And it's that person from before. I might have to fight this person. So if I strike, with showing courage, whatever that may be. And this person tries to take the baby. So you hold back. There's fire that comes out. You say, stop, right there. You put your hand in front, you say, stop. You do not cross this line. This baby person tries to take the baby again. You say no, and you strike. So the eye opens, and you strike forward. Exactly. You keep the baby hush. You let them know, again, strike. Nothing will come between you. Your fear is gone. The bibhatsa is gone. Beautiful. Now with the child, you return back. You come to your abode. You lay the child down. And you hold in peace. Up. Take a few deep breaths. And out, in, and out, in, and slowly come up, and come together. Beautiful.
All right, so we're gonna come a little bit back to the screen for just a moment. Hi, Chris, thank you. So we're gonna come, that was beautiful, you guys. I didn't get to see all of you, but I definitely got to see some of you. And hopefully this started something without a lot of movement. The creativity, this aspect of playing around, this aspect of expressing, because sometimes we're told so much to keep it all internal, to actually express outwardly. It's a different feeling and it gives different heat in the body. Tapas, okay? This tapas, this heat. All right, now we're gonna go transition to folk dance because, and we're gonna use some of these emotions in the folk dance. So it's Navratri right now. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Navratri, but it's these days of the goddesses and the 10th day will be coming up. And this is a song that kind of celebrates from that region. So when we're doing these folk movements, now it's not so classical, it's more open-ended, but I'm going to incorporate some of these emotions and hopefully you guys feel free to lip sync and I'll explain the song to you as well. So right now I'm just gonna play the song and I'm gonna show you the steps. We're gonna be very technical with it, just like the process of classical dance. Steps first, then emotions, and then kind of performing it. Yes? Okay, so what we're gonna do now is going to play the song. All right. Can you guys hear it okay? Yes. Don't worry, I'm a dance teacher. I'm going to pause and guide you through this. I'm not going to be like, and go, okay? So basically this first step is freestyle. We've got a couple different bangs, okay? So we're going to hit to side, side, down, and down. How you want to hit these is on you. It's complete freestyle, okay? So we're going to hit to the side, down, and down, okay? Beautiful. So it's just very strong beating of the drums that's in this song. Okay, all right. And then another motion is, this is freestyle, but I'm gonna do a flower with my hands, okay? If you wanna see, it's one wrist on top of the other, and I just open and close it. You don't have to do this, but I'm gonna do a flower down, beautiful, beautiful. Yes, 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 yes. So that's kind of the freestyle beginning. The main step is coming when she speaks. So she's gonna go, bhintana ka bhintana, aja aur kesara. She's basically calling out to the people, everybody come and listen, okay? So again, we're gonna open up and call out. Beautiful, one more time. And open up and call out. From here, she says, pero se bedi zara khol, which in Hindi basically means, take off the shackles from my feet. She's bound, she feels restricted that she can't go to her love. Her family, her conditionings have bound her. So she says, she cries out, open these shackles from my feet. I wanna break free from them. Yes, exactly. So basically I'm going to take the shackles of my feet, open, open, and bar, bar, open the doors. Yes, one more time. Foot down, and open. One more time. Foot down, and open. Yes, beautiful. So we're gonna go from here, from the very first thing she says. So we're gonna go, dhinkana ka dhinkana, aja aur kesara, pero se bedi zara khol. Beautiful, that's the count for it, okay? One more time. 5, 6, 7, and dhinkana ka dhinkana, aja aur kesara, pero se bedi zara khol. Beautiful, you guys, last time, one more time. 5, 6, 7, and dhinkana ka dhinkana, aja aur kesara, pero se bedi zara khol. Beautiful. Let's try that much with music and then we'll add on, okay? Because I want to explain it to you. All right. Okay. In the beginning, you're allowed to move down the floor. And then move down. I'm gonna do that part again and then I'm gonna add on. Is everybody okay? Can somebody give me a thumbs up? Perfect, thank you. Okay, so I'm gonna do this one more time. We've got freestyle in the beginning. There's a sound of a horn. Now this song is not for the fear faint hearted. It is a courageous song. She's announcing to her entire family that I love this person, all right? And I'm willing to give everything. I'm gonna tear my shackles. Nothing scares me. Death doesn't even scare me. I'm gonna go. So that's what this song is about. It's her reveal. So it's a very big announcement. So you're going around whatever that feeling is for you, of courage, of bravery, okay? And then there's the bell chimes, okay? In Navratri, we also light up the diyas. We light it up. So she's lighting up the diyas, all right? Okay, so you're gonna come around, you're gonna hit up, hit down, hit down. We do the flower to the side, flower to the side. And then all we're doing is kind of walking up to the front before she announces, okay? So however you wanna walk up, you're just gonna take your walk up, and we go, bhingtana ki bhingtana, aja aur kesarat pairo se bedi zara kho. Now from here, she says, beat the drum. Keep it going, beat the drum. That's what she's saying. So you're gonna turn, beat the drum. We have drums with two ends, some of our drums, the dhol. So you're going to beat the drum, okay? You're gonna turn the other way around, beat the drum. Beautiful, let's try that again. Doesn't matter which direction you do first, okay? You're gonna turn, beat the drum, turn, beat the drum. One more time, 5, 6, 7, and turn, beat the drum, turn, beat the drum. Beautiful, all right? From here, we're gonna go. Turn, beat the drum, turn. You're gonna go, sorry. When I break it down, I sometimes lose it. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go, dhol baje, dhol baje. Now what we're gonna do is we're gonna reach out the opposite direction. 1, 2, 3, and 4, okay? So I'm gonna reach out diagonally with my hand. My hand is in a padma. That's the flower posture. This is hard for a lot of people sometimes if you're not familiar. All my fingers are stretched out. So take your hands out like this. All right. I'm going to pull my pinky finger, all of them. I'm really stretch them out. Don't bend the wrists. Keep them straight. Yes. And if you cannot do the movement, just reach out with a flat hand. That's fine as well. Okay. So just reach out with a padma or a flat hand. Okay. Beautiful. So we're going to go out, two, down, up, flat. One more time, 5, 6, 7, and out, two, down, up, up. Very simple, again, 5, 6, 7, and down, two, down, up, up. Beautiful, it's just my head, down, up, up. I can jump with it if I want. I can get extra with it, okay? You can always go higher, all right? So I'm gonna go 1, 2, 3, and 4, okay? Yes, exactly, 5, 6, 7, and 1, 2, 3, and 4. Beautiful. So we're gonna do it slowly from the drum. I'm gonna turn, drum, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Yes, okay, great. One more time, 5, 6 from the drum. Turn, drum, 1, 2, 3, and 4. It's a little fast, I know, okay? There's not an exact count because the song's a little faster. That's why I'm a little off, okay? One more time, 5, 6, 7, and a turn, drum, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Yes, we're almost done. So I want you guys to really have fun with this. Okay, awesome, let's try it from the top. We're pretty much almost done. Are you guys okay? Can everybody give me a thumbs up? If you have questions, feel free to ask me, okay? All right, so let me show one more step to you guys. So basically we have a little time. It's not as fast as I was doing. We're doing nagare sangha, dhol baje, dhol, there's a pause. Dhai, dhai, dham, dham, dhai. After that, we're just kind of digging down. You're just scooping, clap, scooping, clap, scooping, clap, scooping, clap. There's a lot of turns in garba dance. It's like circle dances. We can't do too much of that right now, but I want you to do your own circle after the whole song is done, okay? All right, because we kind of like reach up to the front, clap with another person, come back, reach up to the front. We have the sticks, the dandya, dancing around the goddess on every night. So that it gives kind of like Rumi. There's like this circular dance connection again with the divine for some people. Okay. All right. Let's try that one more time because I want emotions. All right. Breathe, you guys. Just have fun with it. Okay, how's everybody doing? We good? Awesome. So I'm just gonna explain. You don't have to sit down. I'm just gonna come close to the camera for you, but you can take a minute. Breathe, okay, from the diaphragm. I wanna make sure that you guys understand. So, dhinkarak, dhinkarak, aja, okay, so now we're adding the motions. So everyone out there, listen. Take out the shackles from my feet. I beat the drum. I beat the drum. I'll keep beating the drum, like the beats of my heart. Okay, that's the essence of it. And it's just that, repeating over and over. If you want to lip sync, a key that I give in Bollywood dancing, pop, not classical, I say watermelon. Watermelon, watermelon, watermelon. It'll look like you're singing, lip syncing along, because there's a lot of lip syncing in our dance. But if you want to know, it's pretty easy. It's nagara sanga dhol. You can just say dhol, dhol baje, beat the drum, dhol baje, and dhol baje. Okay, so there's not just one emotion in this. There's a lot. There's strength, there's courage, there's worry, there's love, there's kind of almost destruction if you get in my way, okay? There's a lot going on here in like 1 minute, okay? So we're gonna do this one more time. Dhinktanak, dhinktanak, aja aur kesarat. Pero se bedi zara khol, nagare sangar dhol baje, dhai dhai dham dham dhai. Nagade sangar dhol baje, dhai 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 dham dhai. And we're just gonna keep freestyling with that, okay? Do you guys understand? Yes? All right, beautiful. Let's keep doing it, you guys. We just got a little bit more. I want you to have fun with it. And as you get more fun with it, play. Play with changing some things around. Play with your emotions, okay? I don't mind what you're doing as long as you keep going, okay? All right, that's why we're doing folk. Okay, there's freedom here, all right? Awesome. You guys, beautiful. How are you feeling? Yes? Okay. Awesome. Awesome. We're going to do that one or two more times. And I just want you to have fun with it. I literally want you, if you have your own move, add it. Okay. Yes. There's a lot of tapas heat. Okay. All right. Awesome. Should I lower the volume? Or are we okay? Okay. Awesome. Thank you. Keep it going. Keep it going. Whatever your emotion is. Everybody good? Can we do that one more time? Yes? Okay, awesome. I want you to completely let go. Whatever comes to you, comes to you. And just let your heart, your gut kind of just speak, okay? All right, let's do this. Where are those juices? That rasa, that flavor, where is it? I want to feel it. All right, breathe. Oh my God. So you should be hopefully feeling a little heat internally and externally. We're gonna close the way we started with our classical Indian dance opening. You're gonna bring your feet together. You're gonna take this heat for a moment. You're gonna take a deep breath in, palms together, and exhale, let it settle. Whatever you're feeling, all that energy, let it come down to this nice bubble. It's still there, but it's this nice bubble. Inhale again, rise up, exhale down. Again. And exhale down.
You're going to take your thumbs up like this. Bend your knees. First position. Stomp the right foot. Stomp the left foot. Come all the way down. You're going to touch, pretend to touch your eyes. Lift up. Feet together, palms together. Namaste. Really bringing it in. Oh my God. Okay. Well, you guys, thank you so, so, so very, very much for your time and attention and just having fun with exploring this. Again, this is not by any means classical dance. We're stemming from this. I want to emphasize that very much because there is a lot of appropriation and misuse that does go on. But I want to address that feeling those feelings and going to that place, that essence, the truth, that's what it's about. And so we all have our ways to get into that place. So I want to say thank you. You. If there's any questions you have, we have a few minutes, but thank you so much for just your energy, your willingness, and just to play around and explore in a creative space. Thank you for giving me the flavors of what you guys are feeling. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mayuri.
Thank you. Yeah, if you guys have any questions, feel free to let me know. You can follow me on Instagram at Mayuri Bhandari Official. I also have a YouTube channel. I do Bollywood on Ice videos there. And I do teach outdoor socially distant yoga asana and dance classes. So I always post on there. So if you guys ever need—
What city?
I'm in Venice. I'm near Venice area. Yeah.
So can you put your handle and or email, whatever your contact is, in the chat for people?
Absolutely, I can. Yes.
That'd be great. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Amy. I will. Thank you guys so much. Does anybody have any questions? Seriously, feel free. Don't be shy. Somebody else might have the same question.
All right. So next is Paula with therapeutic flow yoga. Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody, again. I hope to see you guys sometime soon. And I left
I can't type on this device, sorry. Where did you get to study your—
Study dance or?
Yeah, this type of dance.
Well, I do all styles of dance. I'm modern, salsa, African, but I did UC Berkeley. I was a student at SMC and UC Berkeley for dance. And I've done dance a little bit in India as well for more classic dance. Yes, a little bit
here. Curious about the Indian dance. I mean, I know Roberta and everybody else at Santa Monica. I'm almost 50-year-old retired dancer, so.
Got it. Yeah, no, basically my Indian dance training, a lot of it Bollywood, we just kind of grow up watching. Nobody really teaches us Bollywood. It's really interesting because it's a pop form from the films. We just watch it from the films. Folk dance I kind of picked up just by the places that I go to, and classical specifically, we have a teacher and you know, different training centers. So I did some of it in India, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So fun, brought a lot of flavor. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you guys so much, okay? Take care, bye.
Your email, may I have it again? Your email?
Sure, I can put that again. Yeah.
Mayuri Bhandari?
Yes, Mayuri Bhandari.
Yes. Please post it in the chat.
Yes, and my IG is at Mayuri Bhandari Official. You guys can just let me know where you find, like you can just let me know, hey, saw you from the LMU thing and it'll click, so thanks.
Thank you so much. It's beautiful.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Very lovely. You're very beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So you teach, you have classes?
Yes, I do. I do. I teach right now. I'm teaching Wednesday nights and Saturday mornings. Sunday mornings. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sunday morning?
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. We have to come to Venice?
Yes, Venice Park. If you email me, I will give you all the information. I put people on an email list and you can get
the information. Okay, thank you, Mayuri. You're lovely. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. You guys too. Thanks, guys. Bye.